Slipped capital femoral epiphysis, SCFE. The hip is a ball and socket joint. The socket is formed by the acetabulum, which is part of the large pelvis bone. The ball is the femoral head, which is the upper end of the femur. Like the other long bones in the body, the femoral growth occurs at each end of the bone around an area of developing cartilage called the growth plate, physis. Growth plates are located between the widened part of the shaft of the bone, metaphysis, and the end of the bone, epiphysis. The epiphysis at the upper end of the femur is the growth center that eventually becomes the femoral head. The growth plate is made up of cartilage, which is a soft, flexible layer. It's a weaker area than the rest of the bone. Slipped capital femoral epiphysis is a disorder of adolescence in which the growth plate is damaged and the femoral head slips down and backward off the neck of the bone at the growth plate. The term SCFE is a misnomer. It is actually the portion of the proximal femur distal to the physis, growth plate, that is displaced anterolaterally and superiorly. This displacement gives the appearance of posterior and inferior displacement of the epiphysis, which in fact remains in normal position in the acetabulum. SCFE usually occurs on only one side. The left hip is affected somewhat more often than the right, for unknown reasons. However, it can occur on the opposite side as well. SCFE is bilateral in average of 25% of cases at presentation. In unilateral slips, SCFE may happen in contralateral normal hips within 18 months from the time of the initial episode. Typically, SCFE occurs in overweight children between 11 and 16 years old and is more common in boys than girls. Obesity is a major risk factor. There may be a genetic predisposition to this condition. It can also occur due to a fall or other injury, particularly in acute and acute-on-chronic slips. Children with SCFE who are younger than 10 years or older than 16 years are likely to have one of these risk factors. Renal failure. History of radiation therapy used in pediatric cancer patients. Endocrine abnormalities, particularly hypothyroidism and growth hormone deficiency. Or genetic disorders, for example, Down syndrome. SCFE is traditionally classified into four patterns of presentation on the basis of intensity and duration of symptoms. Pre-slip. Children with pre-slip have pain but no discernible displacement of the epiphysis. The patient may also present a slight or mild limp. Radiographs demonstrate widening of the proximal femoral physis compared with the opposite asymptomatic hip. Acute slips. Children with acute slips have symptoms of less than 3 weeks duration. Acute traumatic slips may occur following major trauma, such as fall from height or motor vehicle accident. Symptoms include onset of severe pain, external rotational deformity, limited range of motion of the hip, shortening, and commonly inability to bear weight. The patient complains of intense pain with any attempt at passive motion. Patients with acute symptoms of SCFE are at risk of further displacement of the epiphysis. To avoid this and for pain relief, patients with an acute slip should immediately be placed in a wheelchair or on a stretcher and remain non-weight-bearing until they have received definitive treatment. Acute-on-chronic slips. The acute-on-chronic presentation occurs when a patient with a history of symptoms and signs of chronic slips, such as limp and/or pain of at least 3 weeks duration, presents with an acute increase in pain and loss of motion of the affected hip. Patients should be made non-weight bearing, as for children with acute slips. Chronic slips. Chronic slips is the most common pattern of presentation. It is characterized by vague, intermittent symptoms over a protracted period, usually considered to be longer than 3 weeks. The classic presentation is a complaint of a dull, aching pain in the hip, groin, thigh, or knee and no history of preceding trauma. The pain may be chronic or intermittent, it is increased by physical activity and relieved with rest. Approximately 15% of patients present with isolated thigh or knee pain. SCFE is more likely to be missed at the initial visit in patients with knee or thigh pain but no complaint of hip pain. Thus, physicians must have a high degree of suspicion to prevent delay in diagnosis, which can worsen prognosis. The affected leg is usually held in an externally rotated position and may be shorter than the unaffected leg. The patient usually has an altered gait. He may also present a slight or mild limp. If the slip is unilateral, the gait may be antalgic. The patient takes a short step on the affected side to minimize weight bearing, which is painful. In moderate or severe unilateral slips, there may be a Trendelenburg gait, a shift of the torso over the affected hip. If the slip is bilateral, the gait is usually waddling. SCFE also has been classified according to biomechanical stability as stable or unstable as follows. Stable slips are defined as those in which walking and weight bearing are possible with or without crutches. Most cases of SCFE are stable slips. Nevertheless, patients with stable slips should be made non-weight bearing until orthopedic consultation and treatment have occurred. Unstable slips are those in which the epiphysis is displaced from the metaphysis or the patient is unable to bear weight, even with crutches, regardless of duration of symptoms. Most of these patients present with severe pain similar to a fracture of the hip. Because manipulation may cause further displacement, patients who have unstable slips should immediately be placed in a wheelchair or on a stretcher and remain non-weight-bearing until they have received definitive treatment. The method of grading slip severity is according to the epiphyseal shaft angle of Southwick, which is measured on the frog leg lateral radiograph. Mild slips have less than 30 degrees of displacement. Moderate slips have between 30 and 50 degrees. Severe slips have greater than 50 degrees of displacement compared with the unaffected side. Differential diagnosis. Avascular necrosis of the hip, Peart's disease, and development dysplasia of the hip with late diagnosis in older children and adolescents may present in a manner similar to SCFE. Other causes of hip pain and limp in children are discussed in a video has been published under the name, Causes of Hip Pain in Children. Diagnosis. The doctor will obtain a complete medical history. He will ask about your child's general health and medical history. He will then ask about symptoms and ask when the symptoms began. While your child is lying down, the doctor will perform a careful examination of the affected hip and leg. Physical examination may demonstrate hip pain on palpation and limitation of hip range of motion, especially internal rotation and flexion. The diagnosis of SCFE usually is made based upon plain radiographs, which reveal an apparent posterior displacement of the femoral epiphysis. The minimum radiographic examination consists of an anteroposterior view and lateral projections of both hips to permit comparison, which may facilitate identification of subtle findings. And because of the high incidence of bilateral disease, on the anteroposterior view, there may be mild widening, lucency, and irregularity of the physis. In the normal anteroposterior view, a line drawn along the superior femoral neck, Klein's line, intersects the lateral portion of the femoral head. In a patient with SCFE, the line passes outside of the epiphysis or just at its superior edge. The posterior displacement and step off of the epiphysis on the femoral neck are better demonstrated on the lateral view. The lateral projections are obtained by the frog leg or true lateral hip radiographs, the cross table view. True lateral hip radiographs, the cross table view, is recommended in patients who have acute slips. Since the flexion and abduction of the hip that is necessary for the frog leg view may displace the physis in these unstable slips. If the radiograph is normal but suspicion for early slip is high, the doctor will refer the patient for MRI. MRI can demonstrate widening of the physis with surrounding edema, essentially diagnostic of the disease. We recommend screening T4, TSH, and bone age and evaluation for kidney disease for those patients who have atypical slip. Younger than 10 years, older than 16 years, short stature. Treatment. I will discuss the treatment of slipped capital femoral epiphysis, postoperative recovery, and complications in next video.